Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the final episode of TV Guidance Counselor for 2017. It's been a hell of a year. Don't need to get into it. I'll probably get into that at some point in the future. But, less about that, the less said about that, the better. But there was good things, too. Anyway, I have a great episode today. My guest is writer Dave Brusie. I really want to call him Dave Brusie. I think he really should call himself that, and we discussed that here. But, that's really up to him. Anyway, I met Dave when he was writing an article about an ACLU benefit that I hosted in the spring, which was an amazing show that I got to be on with former guests of the show, Juliana Hatfield and Bill Janovitz. And then Evan Dando was on the show, and The Gravel Pit, and Not a Surf. It was just a ridiculously belly was on the show. I had no business being on it, but Dave wrote a great article about it for the Boston Globe. He's a great writer, really good dude, and I very much enjoyed talking to him. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor, the final one for 2017, with my guest, Dave Brusie.
TV is my friend, and has been always there for me in time of need.
Mr. Dave Brusie, how are you?
I'm good, Ken. How are you?
Good. I really want to say Brusie.
You can.
It sounds so much like fancier.
It does. And I think that's how it was pronounced way back when, because it does have French-Canadian origins.
Yeah.
Maybe I should start doing that.
You should.
Calling myself Dave Brusie.
Yeah. Did you get like a lot of made fun of as a kid, like, hey, Brusie?
Yes. Yeah. And I was telling you before, I'm an English teacher at the high school level, and I still, kids are often like, hey, Bruiser.
Oh,
like, I have heard all these, right?
But Bruiser's like a good nickname.
That's true.
Because that's like, it's almost like tough guy.
Right.
I mean, it's sort of offensive, but at the same time, like, you know.
Right, I suppose I should be flattered.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I should mention Dave showed up shirtless and oiled up also.
Yes, when he's jacked. That's true.
Yeah. So it's Bruiser Brusie.
And I do have a Bruiser tattooed on me, but
yes,
still.
Right across the chest.
Yeah.
But Bruiser Brusie would be like a wrestler's name whose gimmick is he's like French Canadian.
Oh, yeah.
Like he just and his finishing move can be called the meat pie.
Perfect. He's got like a beret and a loaf of French bread.
He comes out with the Canadian
pummels
flag.
People with the French bread.
Yeah, yeah. Bruiser Brusie. You found your second career here.
Absolutely.
So you immediately said, you know, I want an issue with Cheers on the cover.
Yes.
And so what I gave you was November 14th to the 20th, 1987,
mm-hmm.
which I believe is the first year of Rebecca on Cheers.
Yeah, there's an article, and it's funny, my memory, I remember her starting later than 87.
Yeah.
That article, I was actually just reading it. It's interesting to see, like, what people involved with the show were, like, worried about as Shelley Long left and she was starting, because she was such an unknown quantity.
She had done Star Trek II.
I always forget that.
And 87, she had already filmed Summer School.
Okay.
But hadn't really done a ton of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And if memory serves, they really eased her into the cast. Like, she wasn't in every episode the first season she was on, because she was like the new, like a corporation bought Cheers and they installed her as the
new
manager.
That's right.
So it was more sort of adversarial.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved that they changed the dynamic because they always had, there was that Sam was, the boss of Diane,
right,
and within Cheers,
mm-hmm.
and it got that sort of culture clash hierarchy because she was this like academic,
right,
and he was a dumb alcoholic athlete
jock, right,
but he was still above her because he worked at the he was her boss, and like that was one of the dynamics on Cheers that was always interesting to me because It's a show about alcoholics, and he's the only sober one.
Right.
So he has that over everybody there.
Mm-hmm.
But he didn't have anything over Diane normally, but in the bar, he does.
Right.
Oh, maybe I'm getting too academic about Cheers.
No, that's awesome. I love, as a teacher, anything like this is so amazing to me.
I mean, it's interesting. Like, I've and you might get this with, because you deal with, like, teenagers now who probably have a wildly different viewpoint of, like, gender and class dynamic than we probably did. But I've had younger friends who've watched Cheers who never saw it and watch it now, and they're like, oh, it's so offensive and, like, you know, misogynist and blah, blah, blah. But I'm like, yeah, but that's the dynamic. Like, that's the dynamic of the show. It's not...
Right.
And I think people miss out, because you grew up around here as well, right?
I did. I grew up in Acton.
Yeah. So there's that Boston thing where... You know, there's 30% of our population is students.
Mm-hmm.
So it's that blue collar versus academia thing
that
is not totally unique to here, but is a huge part of, like, Boston culture. Right. And I think if people don't grow up here, they don't recognize that aspect of the Sam and Diane thing either.
That's
true.
I mean, yeah. And then there's certainly, like, a class dynamic there, too. And, you know, it's funny when I see it now and I have revisited it, like, the Boston stuff, they actually get pretty well.
Yeah, it's pretty accurate.
They're often, like, reading the Boston Globe, but not in, like, an artificial way. It's just there, and they refer to, like, Globe articles, and I even think Cliff is, like, a Boston... I mean, his accent is exaggerated, but pretty great.
He's an archetype that you... And I don't know how true this is, but Ratzenberger takes credit for this, and he grew up in Connecticut. But I think he auditioned for, like, Norm or something like that, and they didn't have the Cliff character.
Oh, wow.
And he was like, do you have a know-it-all?
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, if you're a Boston bar, you need to have, like, the bar know-it-all, you know, like the trash heap in there. For a rock reference. But and so they kind of morphed that character into him.
Okay.
Oh,
that's so great.
And even that's an interesting dynamic, because he doesn't really know much.
Right.
But they do look to him for knowledge, or like some of the people do.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like he's a total, this idiot thinks he knows stuff. There are also people within the bar who are like, gotta ask Cliff, he knows.
Right.
Which is an interesting extra layer.
I just think that those kinds of dynamics, and also, like, the individual interpersonal dynamics, are just so consistent throughout the show. Like, having watched a lot of it recently, like, it's amazing how well, especially when Rebecca came on board.
Yeah, and it was a totally different vibe. They didn't just, and they were very good at that, replacing beloved characters on Cheers, which happened a couple times.
Right, with Coach.
With Coach and being replaced with Woody. They didn't just do a carbon copy, like, store brand version of the character that left, which they often do in shows.
Right.
They use it as an opportunity to totally change the dynamic, which is really interesting, because, like, the Coach dynamic, again, for people who are just tuning in, this... I didn't intend for this to start off as an academic one, but we'll get to dumb stuff soon. But I do enjoy this kind of talk. I went to college, everybody. You wouldn't know it normally. But the Coach dynamic was interesting, because although Coach was an idiot, in theory, much like Woody was, but because Sam was above everyone else, Coach was always above him, because he used to be his coach.
Right.
So it had that... he looked at him as, like, a authority and a father figure, like a sage advice person. Mm-hmm. So it was an extra layer. And then when Woody replaced him, it sort of forced Sam to take that role.
Right.
Which he didn't have to do before.
Right.
So it changed, you know, the characters grew, and they did a similar thing with Diane and Rebecca.
Right, right. So I like what you pointed out about, like, the sort of high status, low status, like, shift. Because Rebecca was also so flawed.
She's a nutcase.
but still above Sam.
Yeah.
And there's also, I mean, the will they, won't they sort of thing happened with them, but not as, I don't know how to, like, describe the difference, but it he seemed to chase her more than she wanted him.
Right. And that seemed more like a, I'm going to try to assert some power over her this way.
Right.
Because she's still above me. It was still a different dynamic, like, In Diane, it was always like, I'm attracted to him because I'm slumming, or like, it's a forbidden, you know, like, it's exotic.
Right.
And it's that
novelty,
was
sort of.
Yeah. And that was always, like, the brilliant thing that the writers and the showrunners of that show brought to that show, like, a consistency. When huge changes happened, it somehow just reinforced the characters even more weirdly, which is how, you know, life works.
Right. That's true. Oh,
man. And yeah, so this was a big deal. And I do want to mention that before we get into Saturday, the very first page, Don Merrill reviews Sledgehammer. which had just premiered that week.
I've still never seen that, though. I hear it's amazing things.
I mean, do you like Silly?
Silly is the best.
Yeah. It was basically like almost a Police Squad style parody. I love Police Squad. You know, it was more Mad Magazine style parody of Dirty Harry. Mm-hmm. And it's really smart and funny and weird.
Mm-hmm.
And had my favorite second season conceit ever. In that they, the first season, this will ruin the final episode. That's of the fine. First season 40, sorry. But they didn't think it was going to get renewed because mm-hmm. it didn't get good ratings. People just didn't. Silly wasn't big in 87. Mm-hmm. I think people just didn't like it. And it was up against Mr. Belvedere. Right. So, I mean, going to get crushed.
Right.
They didn't think they're going to have a second season. So the final episode of the first season is Sledge is trying to defuse a nuclear bomb. And doesn't.
Oh, I think I've read about
and
this.
And all of Los Angeles has exploded. So they're like, look, that's it. And then they're like, hey, you're renewed. So the first episode of season 2, they retitled the show Sledgehammer the Early Years. And it all took place just the year before.
Oh, it's like, amazing.
That's fantastic.
I need to look into that more.
It's a good show, and it's only 2 seasons, and it's a fun watch.
Are there any names that I might recognize as like a...
That were in it.
Yeah.
David Rashi is Sledgehammer. He's a Second City guy. He did some SCTV stuff. But Mary Warrenov is in an episode.
Okay.
There was an episode that was a tribute to Andy Kaufman.
Wow.
With all these Elvis impersonators, because the guy that created the show was a friend of Andy Kaufman's.
Mm-hmm.
But this does not answer your question, by the way. I'm sorry.
No,
but one of my favorite things is they couldn't get the rights to use any Elvis songs. So all the Elvis impersonators do the same song, and the song is just them going, Elvis. Woo, Elvis. And so like every single time one performs,
wow.
And which is so much funnier and bizarre. It's really great.
This sounds so much more like self-aware than I thought the 80s could ever be.
It was, I mean, we did get that then, and this was an ABC show, I believe. And ABC weirdly got a little experimental, and I don't know if just no one was paying attention, but like mm-hmm. they were doing Moonlighting at this time, which was really self-aware.
Right.
Sledgehammer, you know, there was a lot of weirdness going on at this time.
I love finding the weirdness that happened sort of without my noticing.
Yeah.
And especially like sort of weird compared to everything else going on at the time.
Yeah.
That always astounds me that it's like, oh, this was happening? I mean, on an obvious level, like Twin Peaks.
Yes.
Even existing and being popular.
And hugely popular for a year.
Yeah. Yeah. When I was 8.
Yeah.
And my memory of being 8 is not Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
So finding those things out later is so interesting.
Yeah. I mean, 1990, like my sweet spot is like 88 to 92.
Okay.
Like
yeah. I
was 12.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an interesting time because it was a pretty big transition from the 80s to the 90s stuff.
Right.
And it was interesting to see these shows that bridged and went into the 90s
mm-hmm.
that I forget had episodes airing into the 90s, like Dallas.
Hmm.
Or like, I think Falcon Crest.
Oh, really?
And Miami Vice, I think, ended in like 91.
Oh, that's odd.
But no one ever remembers that. Looking at those episodes,
mm-hmm.
you know, now it's really sort of anachronistic how they don't quite fit.
Right.
Even though they were like the trendsetter
mm-hmm.
for the previous decade.
Well, even like the Cosby Show and Cheers, you think of as sort of like 80s institutions, but they both ended in
92
and 93 for Cheers. I think.
Yeah.
So you said you were 8 in 88?
88, yeah.
Yeah, I was too. So we must be... Are you 37?
I'm 37.
There you go.
And, you know, NBC, when these two shows ended, they mm-hmm. were like, we're screwed.
Right.
Because they were in the toilet when those shows started, and those shows saved that network.
And then it was another couple of years before Friends, right?
Friends started in 94, 95, I think.
So they... Okay.
So it was like one season. But at the same time, like, they were like, we don't have an anchor.
Right.
They sort of had Seinfeld, but it still wasn't as big as...
Not quite yet, yeah.
Yeah. So they were like, what are we going to do? And then, you know, it got so much bigger,
mm-hmm.
which is insane. I did just open this up to an amazing ad for Small Wonder, by the way.
Oh.
And it has some really terrifying commissioned art. And, whoo boy. Small Wonder lights up America's comedy circuits.
Oh. And it did, didn't it?
It did, and it was a creepy creep.
That's one of those things where, like, you look back and you're like, this is not normal.
No. Can you imagine, like, you know what used to terrify me about that show, and I think I mentioned it before here, is the kids slept every night with Vicky in his closet.
Huh.
That's where she slept, in his bedroom, in his closet, standing up.
That's very strange. And then he just opened the door and, like, turned on the switch. Yeah. In the
morning. Get up, Vicky! Annoying little kid. Yeah, like, that's insane.
Yeah.
That's insanity. Yeah. So this is a very important night, by the way, too, because Fox premiered, the network itself premiered on Saturday night in 1987.
Wow.
In November, it had just started. This was the first year of Fox.
Interesting.
And they only did for Saturday and Sunday.
Okay.
They were a weekend network.
And they started a sort of like weird programming, right?
I mean,
partly out of necessity, but also like that was sort of their thing, right?
Yeah. Yeah. They didn't really have a voice yet because they were trying to just like, we're going to be what everyone isn't
right
now. And their flagship show was Werewolf.
Oh.
They put all their money into Werewolf.
No knowledge at all about
Werewolf. No. I've
never heard.
Everybody else. Wow. But it was basically Incredible Hulk, but with a werewolf.
Okay.
And then America's Most Wanted was big.
Okay.
Cops, right. They started with. Married with Children became like a fluke hit. That was actually like a total afterthought, that show for them. Huh. And that became the blueprint for all the sitcoms they did after that.
Okay.
They were like, oh, this is what people like. So they went like trashy. That was their thing.
Am I remembering right that there was a sketch show on Fox called The Edge?
Yeah, with Julie Brown. Yeah, that was 91.
Okay.
Yep. That was Wayne Knight, Jennifer Aniston, Tom Kenny. Tom Kenny and Jill Talley were Mr. Show, and also SpongeBob SquarePants. They met on The Edge.
Okay.
That's where they met.
I sort of, in my memory, that sort of like merges with the Ben Stiller show as like this, like,
yeah.
That's also Fox, right?
That was also Fox, okay. Yeah. David Merkin did The Edge after Get a Life ended.
Okay.
And concurrently with working on The Simpsons.
Okay. I think that's sort of like the beginning of my awareness as like, of comedy as like something that I really liked.
And Living Color was on at that time.
I was not allowed to watch In Living Color.
Oh, so you had some rules about what you could and couldn't watch.
I did. Yeah. And not overly strict. I think, you know, at the time, my sister, who's a little under 2 years older than me, she and I were not allowed to watch certain things, and we were not allowed to watch R-rated or PG-13 movies until like we were of like the legal age for those things.
So your parents were very like letter of the law.
They were, and like, you know, we watched things like Cheers and like things that were adult but not in inappropriate ways, but more like, why does an 8-year-old care about like Murphy Brown, for example?
Yeah.
Like, I loved that show, and looking back, I'm like, why did I care?
Well, it was just good, though.
It was
you
good.
Know, the characters were good. I watched it, and I also watched, like, 30-something and, like, Sisters and that kind
of
stuff.
Oh, I loved Sisters, yeah.
Yeah, but those were mature, but not adult.
Right.
I guess you would say.
And it's just, yeah, it's just funny thinking back, like, and as a parent now, I have two small children, two young daughters, and, like, I get it now. I'm glad, I think, that I wasn't allowed to watch, like, Beverly Hills Cop when I was 6 or whatever.
Yeah.
At the time, my friends, I was so jealous that they got to see all this, but I think now I get it.
Here's a phenomenon that I've noticed among my friends whose parents were strict, and by that I mean, like, good parents, unlike mine. hold on one moment, I'm going to shut this window.
Sure.
Just gonna shut the window. And then that's fine. Poor Rachel is in like dog control. this weird phenomenon among my friends who had strict parents that didn't let them watch like certain movies, they would get around it by buying the novelization.
Oh, yeah. I think, like, I did that a couple times.
So, like, Scholastic Book Club.
Mm-hmm.
That was, like, their, oh, you mean I can read about Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom?
Right.
Or whatever it was. And the parents were fine with that.
Right.
Because they were like,
they're books.
You're reading. It's fine.
Right.
Sure, read the
Exorcist. Remember buying the novelization of Gremlins 2, The New Batch.
Nice.
Which I think I've still never seen. I know it's supposed to be this.
You've,
like,
never seen it?
I know it's supposed to be this, like, self-referential,
big
amazing
time
thing. And so I would like to say, but I can't even imagine what that book was like, given the levels of irony in the movie.
I remember, I'd like to revisit the book, because I bought that through Scholastic. Although, you know, I preferred Troll Book Club, everybody.
Oh, I forgot about Troll. Oh, my goodness.
Troll was just the better book club. They had weirder stuff. They had more books about monsters.
Oh, man. That day when the book club book box came to class.
Yeah.
Still,
yeah, you'd get that paper pamphlet, fill it out, and then it took just long enough to forget that you had ordered stuff.
Absolutely.
And then you were like, my God. Although it was embarrassing when, for those who didn't have a lot of money, when like the times you didn't get books and everyone else did.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
That and the was, kids who got like oof. 7 books.
Yeah. And didn't care.
Right.
They were like, ugh, my parents made me buy books.
I wonder if teachers, thinking back on it now and being a teacher, if like they saved the reveal of the box for like specific strategic moments. They must have.
Mine didn't. They made a big deal out of it. Like if people didn't get any, they everybody knew.
Oh.
Yeah, no, they made a big display or like getting an award.
Oh, I just mean like it, like the students generally had to like everyone had to like sort of earn it to get to the point where like,
oh, because they're like this will distract everybody for the yeah, rest of the day.
Right.
I don't remember. I feel like we did get it at the teachers. End of the day.
I think we did too. And I think even the end of the week, like it was a Friday.
Yeah.
I'd love to know now.
I feel like it was the end of the day because thinking about it now, if they gave us a box of books with like gross jokes in them at, you know, first thing in the morning, there's no way we're doing anything
right.
all day.
Right.
Yeah. Did you ever teach anything but high school? Did you teach younger? Like
no. And I'm only in my, second year of real teaching, by which I mean before 2 years or, but I've done 2 years of like real teaching, and a year of student teaching. So I'm very early in the teaching process, but,
cause it's going to be a totally different kind of teaching. Cause I know I have a bunch of friends are high school teachers, but I feel like elementary school cause you're with the same kids all day.
Mm-hmm.
It's gotta be partly like life coaching, babysitting, right. adulting mm-hmm. versus straight up learning.
Yeah. And there's certainly an amount of like, actually my favorite part about it is that sort of interpersonal connection you can make with teenagers.
Yeah.
I just think they're just like the greatest age group. It's just, they're at that point right before adulthood where you can still make an impression that you notice.
Right.
But they are sort of like adults and they haven't sort of lost that innocence that so many of us have. I think.
They're not cynical, but that you can have a conversation with them about real stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think my mom taught second grade for years. My dad was an elementary school guidance counselor. And so I saw the crazy amount of work that it took. Not that high school doesn't take a crazy amount of work, but like to your point that it's just, it's insane. Like you're on your feet all day long. You have to know about math, which terrifies me. Yep. Even like elementary school level math. Like you just have to sort of have this wide range of knowledge about things that
today we're going to teach history and now it's math. Yeah.
Nope.
Yeah. That was, I remember in fifth grade, it was a big deal when we had 2 fifth grade teachers, so you know you get this one or this one.
Mm-hmm.
But that was the first year that like they had one thing that each teacher specialized in, so we would swap classes.
Yes,
for an
we
hour.
Had that for sixth grade.
Yeah,
yep.
And it was like a really, you know, it was like the move to chapter books.
Right, absolutely.
It's a big deal.
Oh, this must be what it is to be an older kid.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So Saturday night, let's jump in. 8:00. What'd you go with?
You know,
November 14th, 1987.
Totally disobeyed your rules.
That's fine.
Which as a teacher terrifies me. I'm so sorry. I started with Monday. I mean, I have something for the following Saturday, but that's not the same.
Saturday? Yeah, there's only one Saturday in the TV guide.
Oh, no, I don't have one for the other Saturday either. Ken, I'm so sorry.
Nothing on Saturday. That's fine. You know what? I will assign you something.
Okay, please.
Saturday in 87 was like my favorite night.
Interesting.
So USA Network did a thing called Saturday Nightmares. They'd show a horror movie from 8 to 10, and then they'd have The Hitchhiker, Ray Bradbury, sometimes Alfred Hitchcock Presents. They'd sometimes show horror shorts. And then at 11, it was a thing called Night Flight, and then that morphed into USA Up All Night. But it was just weird horror movies and all kinds of stuff. But NBC Saturday Night 87 was the final season of Facts of Life, which is my favorite season. And this is a really big deal night for me. Mm-hmm. This was the introduction of Pippa, who was Sherrie Krenn, she was a new cast member.
Mm-hmm.
She was Australian. I had the biggest crush on her ever. 7-year-old me was completely in love with Sherrie Krenn.
Mm-hmm.
I think she was like 14, you know, this like spunky Australian girl.
Mm-hmm.
And this was in the height of America's obsession with Australia. So this is when we had young Einstein.
Oh, right.
This
Crocodile Dundee.
Crocodile Dundee. Jocko. You remember who?
Jocko, no.
He was a big Australian guy who was like, Energizer! Oi! Like, he was a rugby player. He got so really popular from these Energizer commercials. He had his own TV show here called The Highwaymen.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was... We had this crazy Australian obsession in 87. I don't know why.
Mm-hmm.
But she was a part of that. And so she got introduced as sort of the new teenage girl, because the other girls were like in their 20s now, and mm-hmm. they were trying to reinvigorate the show.
Right.
And this final season, they did everything possible to try and keep this show going.
This is like the Cousin Oliver of...
Facts of Life Cousin Oliver like 41 times. They tried 5 backdoor pilots for 1987, uh-huh. in the final year. None of them worked, and they threw a Hail Mary in the last 2 episodes of the show. They tried to bring it back to Eastland, which was the original concept of the show, was this all-girls school.
Mm-hmm.
And it was going to go out of business, and Blair bought the school, became the new headmistress, and they made the school co-ed. And so they had this new band of students that was Juliet Lewis, Seth Green, Pippa, who was Sherrie Krenn, and they tried to spin it off as almost like a, you know, Eastland school, the new generation kind of thing, and it just didn't work.
Wow. See, Facts of Life is like just before my like real TV watching awareness, I think. Like I vaguely remember that and Different Strokes and stuff, but it's like I feel like my like real awareness started like 88, even though we're talking about an 87 issue, like Cheers was on my radar, but why as a 7-year-old?
Well, I mean, I think it's probably because the Boston aspect, I think, was really appealing to a lot of people. It was like a pride thing. I mean, 87 was my Facts of Life year. They ran a store called Over Our Heads that was like Spencer Gifts, which I've just like spent my whole life trying to recreate to live in. But Sherrie Krenn is now a country singer, and she changed her name to Sherrie Austin. And I think somewhere near you, I have an autographed album from her somewhere. It's over there somewhere.
Wow.
She's great, and she was introduced to the show as an actress and then became a singer. So this was this was a huge night for me. I was like, my God, who is this?
That's how I felt. I feel like everyone was supposed to have a crush on Winnie Cooper on The Wonder Years, but I had the biggest crush on Madeline, the exchange. She wasn't an exchange student, was she?
No.
Did she move to town or something?
Yeah.
Oh man.
Yeah. Yep. She was, everyone had a crush on her.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Kevin did all right.
Yeah.
No, just generally. So I would have gone absolutely Facts of Life. Do you want to mention there was also a new show based on a comic book, based on a Tim Sale underground comic book. Mm. And this was on CBS called Sable. And it didn't last long, but it was kind of a cool show.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really early in that weird, you know, no one was really doing a lot of comic book stuff then.
Mm-hmm.
And then Mr. President was on, which was the show that Fox, the sitcom Fox, put all their chips in.
Interesting.
This was Madeline Kahn. So this is the second season Madeline Kahn was introduced.
I love Madeline.
It was originally a single camera sort of shot on film show about the president and his family in the White House.
Wow.
And the president was played by George C. Scott.
Wow.
Yeah. And they introduced Madeline Kahn late in the second season to try to make it more of a comedy.
Was she like the first lady?
She was the first lady, left him.
Okay.
And she was his sister, her sister, who came in to like help raise the kids.
Wow.
One of which was Andre Gower, friend of the show from Monster Squad, been on the show.
Huh.
But it was produced by Ed Weinberger, who had created the Cosby Show, co-created, and had Conrad Bain was in it. It had this like amazing cast of sort of old men who had like real sitcom pedigree. Steve Ladisberg from Barney Miller. Like,
oh, wow.
And it just bombed.
It sounds good.
It's not good.
That's too bad.
It's fascinating to watch now as like a curiosity, but and George C. Scott was a nightmare. Like there was a point on the show where I had so many guests who had horror stories about George C. Scott. And
really?
I don't mean like Harvey Weinstein horror stories,
right.
But just like him being like an angry jerk.
Oh, that's too bad.
To them, it got to the point where I was just like, when people sit down, I should just be like, what horrible thing did George C. Scott
say
to you?
It's too bad when those, like, you know, that's sort of his thing as an actor. And he uses so hilariously in Doctor Strangelove. But then to like, oh, it's such a bummer.
He had a drinking problem and was an angry guy and was older. And so that was on as well. And then at 8:30, 227 is on, which I love. One of my favorite shows.
That, again, was like one of those that were like just barely before my awareness. I feel like, so did we have like Golden Girls and Empty Nest and stuff yet?
Yep. Golden Girls at 9. Empty Nest wasn't yet. At 9:30, they had a lot of trouble finding what to put at 9:30. They eventually landed on Amen.
Oh, yeah.
And right. Amen was on for years. But Fox that night, because they really were rolling out all the stops here, at 9, they had The New Adventures of Beans Baxter, which was a show created by Savage Steve Holland.
What?
Who did Better Off Dead.
Yeah.
And Summer. And it was about a teenage spy. So his dad, Beans Baxter, was like a James Bond type and was kidnapped. So he had to take on the role to like get his dad freed from this spy agency.
Oh my gosh. I'm so fascinated by early Fox now.
Yeah.
I just want, because like, I think my real awareness of Fox started with like, what was it called? Parker Lewis Can't Lose.
Yeah.
Like, it was, which was like a little weird, but in a great way.
Yeah.
But these just sound bonkers.
Oh, yeah. And 8:30, I forgot to mention, against 227, mm-hmm. Fox was airing a show called Women in Prison.
Oh.
Which was a show about women in prison. And it was a sitcom. It was a three-camera sitcom, funny show about women in prison. Wendy Jo Sperber was in it from Back to the Future.
Oh.
And, bizarre. Just bizarre. And the weirdest show they had. Now, 9 o'clock, I'm watching HBO because they're showing Comic Relief 87.
Oh, wow.
Live. 100% watching that. You know, Harry Anderson, Billy Crystal, Martin Short, Tracy Ullman, Robin Williams.
Oh, that's amazing.
I mean, you had to watch it. Absolutely. The entire cast of SNL circa 87 was on it, which is Dana Carvey, Victoria Jackson, John Lovitz, Kevin Nealon.
Oh, man.
Yeah, Stephen Wright is on it. Malcolm Jamal Warner, Marsha Warfield, Paul Schaefer, Paul Rodriguez, Paul Reiser, Tom Poston.
So many Pauls.
Penn and Teller, Catherine O'Hara, Rue McClanahan, Dudley Moore,
Dick Gregory. I want to watch that right now.
Andrea Martin, Bobcat Goldthwait. This is the year that Bobcat Goldthwait came out and did the Bono impression.
I have not seen this. That? No.
It's very funny.
That sounds amazing.
There's no way I wasn't watching that. But in addition to the New Adventures of Beans Baxter, at 9:30, Fox had one of the weirdest shows they aired. And this show changed names three times, changed concepts three times, with the same cast, and by this time it was called Second Chance. And the premise of the show was this guy dies in 2010, I think, or 2000. Mm-hmm. So you get this weird 87 future, which is really bad. And he wasn't bad enough to go to hell and wasn't good enough to go to heaven. So they send him back to 1987 to live with his teenage self.
Oh, man.
To encourage him to just go one way or the other so that he can actually move on to something.
See, that sounds fantastic.
It's crazy. So he ends up, his adult self ends up renting an apartment above the garage mm-hmm. in his teenage self's home because he has a single mom.
Mm-hmm.
And the mom doesn't know it's the future self, but he reveals himself to himself. It's like this really weird show.
Oh, man. These all sound like they would actually do pretty well nowadays.
Yeah.
If done right. But that sounds totally out of place.
The teenage self of the guy was played by Matthew Perry.
Fantastic.
Yeah. It was... It's not as good. Like, you kind of like, that's so weird that it has to be good.
Right.
It's not. But it's interesting.
Now, was Get a Life on at this point?
Get a Life started in 89.
Okay.
So, not yet. Okay. But they were doing... If you had approached that show, that mm-hmm. concept, with a Get a Life sensibility,
mm-hmm.
that would be a great show.
Sort of like some self-awareness that...
Yeah, but it was more just like a generic sitcom with this really weird high concept.
So, how many of these, I'm curious, like as someone who loves television, like... How many of these do you simply remember or know from looking up on YouTube, or have you sought out?
A lot of these I remember. I've been tape trading for like 20 years.
Okay.
I do it a lot less now because a lot of stuff's on YouTube, but mm-hmm. what I specialized in mm-hmm. was whole blocks. So like 2-hour blocks of television with all the commercials and everything.
Amazing.
And I started with, when I was 5, I didn't want to play T-ball, and I made my parents buy a VCR to tape Saturday morning cartoons so mm-hmm. that I would play T-ball, and then I got kicked off the team, but that's a side story. Wow. So I had about 20 tapes of Saturday morning lineups. And that's what I started with.
Mm-hmm.
And then through trading, I have like 6,000 or 7,000 DVDs of,
that's amazing.
You know, DVDRs of lineups.
Mm-hmm.
So early Fox, I actually have this night.
Okay.
That's this crazy. Whole block. So I've rewatched them all, but I did remember, I was surprised how much of it I remembered mm-hmm. and how vividly, but I have, you know, I guess cheated and I have mm-hmm. revisited in sort of my adult brain,
mm-hmm.
but it's really interesting to see how accurate my memory was.
Bet, right.
Which
right.
I was like, oh, how strange. Yeah. So that this is a weird night. There's like,
I'm so glad
there's so much to watch.
Issue.
Yeah. So then did you do Sunday?
No, you know.
Okay. Why don't we just go with how you started?
Would
you start with Monday?
I did. Thankfully. So I, even though this isn't quite prime time, I'd love the fact that Jeopardy is there.
Oh yeah. 7:30
is, and it's been 7:30 for at least in Boston for ages. Hasn't
yeah.
it?
Since it started at night. Yeah.
And by the way, I'm just so glad I'm talking to a fellow well, we're the same age, but also grew up in Boston at the same time. So it's very exciting that we could sort of
commiserate.
We could both mention the movie Loft and know what that means.
Absolutely.
But Jeopardy, you know, I've never had a DVR, but I've often thought, like, if I had a DVR, it would just probably be all Jeopardy. Because I never seem to be able to, especially with two small children, to just, like, sit down and watch Jeopardy. But there's something just amazing about it that just soothes me instantly.
Well, you feel like you're doing something.
You do. Yeah, that's funny. Yeah.
Because you're like, I'm learning, right?
Right.
But, you know, you're not.
No.
Yeah.
And you get that sense of superiority if you get Final Jeopardy, but they don't.
Right,
but then again, you're not. No, you're not doing anything.
And I've never been on a quiz game show, but having done like quiz show podcasts or like, you know, live quiz shows that everyone's like, oh, these people are so dumb. And like, I know a lot of stuff. Right. But when you're on it, it is different. Like and it's not even a panic. Like, it's just, you don't have all your faculties.
Right. No, I can't. I have never wanted to be on Jeopardy because it sounds terrifying. There was actually an episode of Family Ties all about that, essentially, right?
He freezes. But that,
is that Nick? No, it's
Alex.
It was Alex,
right? Yeah. Oh. Weirdly, that's one of the cliche plot lines of a sitcom. Like, at some point, they have people go on a game show and freeze, which I think the first one I know of, and I may be wrong, was there's an infamous one that the Honeymooners, where Jackie Gleason gets on the show, and as soon as the camera comes on, he starts going and like is catatonic.
Uh-huh.
But almost every sitcom's done that since.
That's interesting.
There's a Cheers where Cliff goes on Jeopardy.
Cliff goes on Jeopardy is one of the greatest things.
Yeah, where people who've never been in my kitchen.
My kitchen.
But it's, you know, and that was such a funny thing, like the know-it-all who would, they'd watch Jeopardy in the bar. And he would get him right. You know, he goes on and he tanks.
It's totally different. Yeah.
And it's a funny take on that concept that's been in a lot of shows.
Right.
I never criticize people for tanking on a game show. Although sometimes they say really dumb stuff.
What's weird is when you watch Celebrity Jeopardy and you have like Wolf Blitzer famously like bombed.
Yeah.
And that doesn't make sense to me.
Well, he's very focused on kind of one thing.
I guess that's true. And in the moment, you know, that's his job.
Yeah.
That was crazy to watch. But Andy Richter, like, pummeled him. And it was just so satisfying.
Because he's not a unitasker. Like, he's not, he's... And that's true of, like, a lot of people who end up being, comedians that go on. Because they kind of have to absorb a wider range of popular culture to try and get stuff out of.
Mm-hmm.
Someone like Wolf Blitzer, it's like, I'm kind of just focusing on, like, politics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so if those aren't the topics, like, he's kind of screwed,
right?
Because he has to just focus on that,
right?
He can't sit and read, you know, a Joan Collins book,
right?
You know,
right. He might not know much about South Pacific,
right?
Or like,
right,
musicals of the 40s, and
50s. Exactly. Mm-hmm. That's I still watch that, and you passed up Charles in Charge and Marblehead Manor.
You know, there are so many hard choices to make. I don't know what Marblehead Manor is, first of all.
It was bad. So this was in 87, ABC, NBC, tried to do a thing called Primetime Now Time, and they tried to expand primetime into the 7 o'clock hour. So they had these very silly shows that they thought would appeal to more younger kids and families, and they were more slapsticky, and Marblehead Manor was one of them, and it was terrible. And it was the first show that I think of that had Michael Richards in it. He played like a butler. It was about like rich people who were bumbling, and it's just bad. It's a lot of slapstick stuff. So we didn't go with that. But what did you go with?
I went with Newhart night. That was another one where, like, I look back and I think, why was I interested as someone that young? But I think I just recognized, like, I've loved Bob Newhart forever. I got to interview him for Boston Globe. And he was just exactly as you would hope him to be.
Yeah.
Just warm and lovely and so funny. But I think just, you know, I think my knowledge of his shows is probably more in the Bob Newhart show. But I do remember watching that with my parents. And that's another thing. Like, my parents and I sort of met in the middle in these types of shows like that. And, like, Designing Women, Murphy Brown.
All the CBS Monday night shows.
Kate were Nally? Those all on the same night?
All the same block.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Kate Nally, Newhart. They had a few things swap in. Like, 87 Frank's Place was on.
Okay.
And, you know, it was a great lineup.
Yeah.
Yeah, Murphy Brown. Newhart is my favorite of the Newhart shows.
It's really good. And reading later about how, like, it started out totally different and they revamped it.
They did, but even that, isn't that much of a revamp.
Okay.
So it's not totally different. They shot on film the first season. I mean, on tape the first season, which mm-hmm. does look a little weird because you're used to the film shot later. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, the humor is there. They replaced Kirk, who was the neighbor,
okay.
who was a really unlikable character intentionally. He's uh-huh. a pathological liar and he's a jerk,
mm-hmm.
but he's like their foil.
Mm-hmm.
And they replaced him with Michael and Stephanie, but there's an overlap. Like they all exist in the show in like season 3.
Okay.
And then they phase out Kirk.
Okay.
But it's not that wildly different. It really gets different the last two seasons. And weirdly speaking, Get a Life, 80% of the writing staff for Get a Life started on Newhart the
really?
Last season because David Merkin became the showrunner.
Okay.
And most of the episodes that season are basically Get a Life episodes.
That's so because I feel like their sensibilities, at least in my memory, are so different.
Check out the final season of Newhart, and it really is like a demo tape for Get a Life.
That's so funny.
It's bizarre.
Wow. And I don't remember much about the arc of the show, but I do remember watching the last episode with my parents.
Yeah.
And seeing I got that last joke.
Because you had watched the original show.
Yeah, like thanks to Nick at Night. And just it still remains like one of the funniest ideas.
It's so funny, and the fact that they were able to keep that totally under wraps till the reveal.
Mm-hmm.
Like there was nothing that didn't get out.
Right.
But then a live audience saw it taped.
Right.
But nobody knew. Like everyone was surprised.
And if you watch it now, it's like just this like mix. The reaction is just like shock.
Yeah.
And laughing, but it's like people. It sounds like they're just like.
Losing their mind.
Yeah, losing their mind. Yeah.
Which they should have. I mean, it is still one of the best endings of a show ever.
Mm-hmm.
It's like not been topped.
And he just never fails to amuse me in it. He's just amazing.
He's so funny. And I'm so jealous that you got to talk to him.
Yeah, it was one of the highlights of like my professional life.
Yeah. I had Julia Duffy on, who was Stephanie.
Oh, wow.
And she's mm-hmm. great. He's one of my biggest like comedic influences.
He's amazing.
Ridley. Did you have anything else for Monday or did you just go to Tuesday?
I also had this show on the Disney Channel that I loved and I feel like is never mentioned anymore, but it's called Danger Bay.
I don't know Danger Bay.
So it was, I think it was Canadian and they sort of imported it for the then sort of early Disney Channel.
Yeah.
It was about this family. I'm sure I'm messing this all up. But it was about this family in, I want to say, like, Vancouver, who they have this, like, it's sort of like an adventure show involving a guy who, like, drives a boat.
Hence the bay.
Right.
Yeah,
I wish I could remember it better.
It sounds Australian, weirdly, because they did show a lot of Australian stuff also on Nickelodeon and Disney Channel at that time. Because, like, there was one called, like, Zoo Family.
Okay.
It was like, this family, we own a zoo.
We bought a zoo. But,
yeah, it was ridiculous.
But this was like essentially a family show, but it involved like saving people and animals. And it was just a really like sweet show, I remember. So I was glad to see that again.
I am, I did not plan this, I swear.
Yes.
But I'm looking at 10 o'clock on Monday night, Cagney and Lacey.
Mm-hmm.
There's an ad in here for the show. This is the plot of Cagney and Lacey tonight. The detectives go undercover on a rigged TV game show.
Oh.
Where each hopes their efforts will bear fruit to get credit for the bust. They're on like a Let's Make a Deal style game show.
Oh my gosh.
I had not looked at that. That just was serendipitous for us talking about game shows.
Now that you've mentioned that trope, I'm sure I'll never fail to see it.
Just think of a million things.
Oh man.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
What'd you do? Something on Tuesday?
Tuesday, I went with Family Ties, as I mentioned. And I actually am not sure now if it was the syndicated version. It was on Tuesdays.
This is the syndicated version because it was on Thursdays.
Oh, and Sundays, wasn't it?
And Sundays. And then it had its final episode in 87, which I believe was on a Sunday.
Okay.
And was one of the most devastating moments of my life at that time.
I loved that show so much.
It's great.
It stands up, too.
I mean,
it holds up.
Yeah.
I think... just like the family dynamic was so great.
Everyone was likable.
Yeah.
Like even Alex, who was kind of the villain
mm-hmm.
of the show, was like a good dude.
Right.
You know, he wasn't like a complete jerk.
Right.
Just yeah.
And I probably knew that I was fairly, my family was fairly liberal and I probably knew at that point that like, even though I didn't know what it meant, that I was like, oh, that's sort of like us.
Yeah.
But there was this kid who was like, not like me, but still I idolized Michael J. Fox.
Yeah. Well, he's so funny and seemed like so together.
Right.
You know? And, you know, when I hear stories now about people I've met or friends that I know that had grew up as child actors and stuff around him, mm-hmm. he was nice to everybody. And when he was filming Family Ties, he was filming concurrently Teen Wolf and Back to the Future.
Oh, I didn't. Oh, right. Teen Wolf as well. Yeah. I knew about Back to the Future. I never thought
about
that.
Yeah. They all overlapped. So he was just like, sleeping, working. Like, you know, a lot of people don't know the grind of a weekly sitcom. Like, you're there all week.
Right, rehearsing.
And, you know, you get a new show Monday, do a table read, rehearse it, and then you're, like, taping it Thursday night. You know, it's like a, you know, and filming a movie on top of that. Two movies.
Right.
Like, nuts. In 87, I think he did Secret of My Success.
Okay,
right. I really like that movie.
Back to the Future was 85. Yeah. Which, Family Ties was at, like, the peak of its...
Yeah.
popularity then. That's insane.
Yeah, he made a movie almost every year, I think, when he was on Family Ties.
That's amazing.
88 was Bright Lights, Big City, and was it Casualties of War that he was in, when he started doing more like dramatic stuff. I mean, he was like, it wasn't just like that one year, it was every year he pretty much did a movie and TV, which was unprecedented at that time too, because you were a movie actor or a TV actor.
Right. And I think, I don't know what it was about him that I like specifically loved, but there's just something about his personality in both that Family Ties and Back to the Future.
He's funny, like, and charming, and just oh, but so even great. Like Justine Bateman, so great on that show, and I mean, everybody on that show is great. You know, Scott Valentine,
as Nick,
you know, Mark Price, who still does stand up now.
Skippy. And I think, you know, seeing it now, I'm like, oh, this was a show about like the liberal dream of the 60s.
Yeah, dying
yeah. In Reagan's America. Not like I was thinking about that at the time, but like, oh, this is an amazing document.
Yeah, it's subversive as hell, that stuff. And, you know, it sounds a little bit trite now as a pitch to be like, we're going to flip it so that the parents are the liberal ones and the kid isn't. But that was nuts.
Yeah.
That was nuts. Like, you just didn't get that. You know, it was Mike Seaver. It was the kids sneaking out. You know, even though the Seavers were, like, pretty liberal parents, like, it was the, you know, us versus them that way. It was never the, you know, get a 401k, you hippie. Right. You know, it was such a weird thing.
Especially with, like, a guy so, like, young and attractive as him. Like,
yeah.
To take that direction with him must have been a risk.
Yeah. And they didn't paint him as a, like, pink shorts, like, I'm gonna take this rec center and make it into a parking lot
the with preppy my yacht cliche
race. Yeah, it wasn't that. It was, you know, he was like legitimately concerned and thought he was doing the, you know, that was the right thing, you know, which is so very great. Odd. Anything else you had on Tuesday?
No. You know, like, none of the primetime stuff really, I didn't really recognize.
Jake and the Fat Man, Houston Nights.
You know, it was
the
stuff
Law
that,
and
like,
Harry McGraw.
I was aware of. Like, I remember seeing commercials for Jake and the Fat Man and being like, what?
Yeah.
Is that?
Yeah.
Like, there's, I get it, there's a guy named Jake, and there's a fat man.
Yeah,
like,
William Conrad, who was canon.
Yeah, cop shows, I feel like, were never quite on my, like, radar at the time.
There was an amazing miniseries that premiered on this Tuesday that was Hoover versus the Kennedys.
Oh.
Now the story has finally been told, after being suppressed for 25 years. Is this the truth behind President Kennedy's assassination, and what of the bizarre triangle between Marilyn Monroe and the Kennedys? Starring Jack Warden of Used Cars as J. Edgar Hoover, Heather Thomas from The Fall Guy as Marilyn Monroe, and Richard Anderson as Lyndon B. Johnson.
Richard Anderson, MacGyver?
I believe so.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's kind of what I'm intrigued by that night.
That is intriguing.
So would you, Wednesday night, did you move on?
Yes.
Moonlighting's also on, and 30-something on Tuesday, which I absolutely would have watched.
You know, like, it is crazy to me the things that I know are supposed to be great and have never seen. Like, Moonlighting, never seen. 30-something.
You gotta revisit both.
I know, especially as, like, I am a 30-something. So,
like, ship your kids off to a boarding school for a year.
Okay.
And then you'll have the time just revisit all these shows.
It would require that.
Yeah. I imagine so. Yeah. Unless you want to get the kids to watch Moonlighting and 30-something.
Sure, why not?
I mean, you know, they're network shows from the 80s. They can't be too bad.
I mean, that's essentially... I wasn't 6 and 3, which is how old my kids are, but, like, again, I was, like, 8 or 9 watching, like, adults in a bar. Like, what?
Yeah.
Why?
What do your kids watch now? Do you watch stuff with them?
You know, it's funny. I was, I wrote down for later in the week, there's a showing of The Great Muppet Caper.
Yeah.
And The Muppets is something I've, like, sort of, in terms of stuff from my youth, that I've tried to foist upon them gently, because I know, like, that it can be sort of I don't know, you annoying, don't want them to react, but also
opposite, the opposite reaction.
Yeah, and if you push it too hard, they might not like it.
Have they liked it?
Yeah, they do. Like, some of those movies are surprisingly scary in ways that I don't remember.
Have you watched Follow That Bird with them?
No.
That's the darkest one.
Oh, is it?
By
That's
far.
That's the Sesame Street one, right?
Yes, by far. Oh. That movie is so underrated. That is, I know people who love the Muppet movies and just overlook that movie.
I vaguely remember that movie.
It's a Muppet movie. Uh-huh. It's a full-on Muppet movie. It's the same cast, you know, the same people, and it's really, really, really good. But is pretty dark, which is weird.
That is weird.
Yeah.
And, you know, the Muppets, I loved the Muppet Show as a kid, and I think, like, that sensibility just, I think, stayed with me, like, the complete silliness.
Yeah. I was, my facetious summarization of the Muppet Show is trying to sing a song and a monster stops you.
Yeah.
That's pretty much every
that's
sketch.
That's the whole thing, isn't it? Yeah. Which works so well for, like, John Cleese, who that's, like, that was his role on Fawlty Towers, essentially.
Just ignore
like,
it. Yeah.
Trying to get something done.
But have you showed them like Muppet Babies or like Fraggle Rock? Have you expanded?
Those we haven't done, and that's probably the way to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Storyteller, which is really great.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably the more sensible thing to do. We did watch The Great Muppet Caper recently. They've seen the Muppet movie.
Kids love Charles Grodin.
Oh, yeah. That's the funny part. It's like, here comes Dom DeLuise in a canoe. Like,
yeah.
Oh, the kids love
kids Dom love DeLuise. Dom DeLuise, yeah.
There are some amazing, and I'm sure like you're aware of this, but the just amazing kids shows now that I'm so thankful are there.
Yeah.
They watch this show on Netflix called Puffin Rock, which is just like adorable and,
yeah.
and really sweet, but not overly so. They are both thankfully into Mr. Rogers, which is
nice.
Like my favorite thing now as an adult.
You will have good children.
Oh,
they will
he's
be good adults.
The best.
Yeah.
He's the best.
He got made fun of so much when we were growing up.
Right.
But he wasn't a lunatic. Mm-hmm. Like he was a genuinely nice guy who had a directive, you know.
Right.
And I did a sort of little short pilot thing called TV Guidance Counselor Investigates once as an experiment, which if you haven't downloaded, go back and download. It's only 10 minutes. But it was, I was reading a TV guide and there was an article about when Mr. Rogers sued the KKK.
Wow.
And I had never heard about it.
I
researched it and I found all the information about it and it was fascinating. And he had testified before Congress and all this. Basically, what the KKK had done was they were going to elementary schools and handing out a phone number to kids. And when they called, it was a guy pretending to be Mr. Rogers on a recording, telling them that, like, Jews are the devil and all
that
stuff.
That's astounding.
And he found out about it and sued the pants off
them. That's great.
And he was really angry.
Huh.
And went public, like, was just, why it's wrong, like, really, as you would expect him to do.
Mm-hmm.
And it is fascinating. He won, and it bankrupted that sort of faction of the KKK.
That's
it was actually
amazing.
One of the sort of death blows for them at that time.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really interesting. And he was constantly like, just be kind. And there's an amazing clip I found of him on the Letterman show.
Oh, I think I might have seen that recently, actually.
Letterman's trying to be a jerk to him.
Yes.
Because that's what he does.
It's like 83
it's
or
early,
so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And but Rogers plays along and he's really cool about it. And
yep.
Letterman tries to pull out the Mr. Robinson's Neighborhood
yes,
as like a don't
Eddie
you
Murphy.
Hate this?
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, no. And he's like, and Letterman's shocked. And
yeah.
he's like, it's clearly coming from a place of love. And that's his experience he's bringing into my show.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes, I went to 8H and I met Eddie Murphy and I thanked him and we hung out. Like, it's like, what?
And Letterman's just like, he just doesn't know what to do with it.
Yeah. He has no, he's just completely
really
disarmed.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, I don't mind being parodied. If it's, you know, if it's someone who legitimately has an interesting take and it's not like a hateful and they're not harming kids by utilizing me.
Right. Right.
And he talks about the KKK thing a little bit in the Letterman interview.
Oh, okay. I don't remember that.
Yeah. It's fascinating.
It's, and yeah, like that, the Eddie Murphy impression was going on and I just feel like it was standard comic fodder to just like portray him as really patronizing.
Yeah. Or like a creep.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which like maybe as an adult watching it now, I'm like, okay, I wouldn't want to be talked to like that as an adult, but like
yeah.
it's perfect for children. And he didn't
yeah.
talk down to them.
No. And it was one of the first things where, you know, he's talking to kids, he's talking to you
directly. Yeah.
And that was, some shows did that here and there, but he did it in a much more intimate way. And
right.
He's one of the guys that I think figured out that kids watch TV in a very personal way.
Right.
And it's a lot of time, it's just them alone mm-hmm. in the TV. Mm-hmm. And it's in their house, and it's the same size as them. You know, it has a really profound, like, personal connection.
Mm-hmm.
And he used that really well.
Yeah.
And George Romero started on his show. And Michael Keaton started on his show.
That's right. I forgot about that. Yeah. I don't think I've seen any episodes with either of them recently.
Romero directed a lot of the little films.
Okay.
And Michael Keaton was a PA.
Neither of them were on camera.
Yeah, okay. It was a Pittsburgh-lensed show.
Right.
So it was like the Pittsburgh industry.
Mm-hmm.
And he, you know, launched the careers just by people, like, getting to work on the show.
Mm-hmm.
It filmed in Pittsburgh, and it was one of the only things filmed there consistently for, like, 30 years.
That's so fantastic.
Which is pretty great. And if you fly to the Pittsburgh airport, they have a Mr. Rogers exhibit.
Really?
In the airport. Yeah, I think it's a permanent exhibit. It's they have, like, a sweater and
That's so great. He's just become one of my heroes, especially as a parent.
Yeah, I mean, all the stuff he did a lot of writing. He wrote some articles for TV Guide, and they're not, like, pop psychology, Dr. Spock. Like, they're just really insightful, interesting, useful things.
I aspire to be as patient and knowledgeable as Mr. Rogers.
We need people like that.
We do.
Did we move on to Wednesday? Is that where we are?
We are on Wednesday. What did I write down? Back to the Future was on.
And okay.
If my parents did not have pay cable, we had like the basic cable, but if we had the movie channel, I would have watched this. Well, 87? Yeah. I
think it would have only been a year old.
I probably saw it around that. Maybe I saw it in 88. It was definitely on video. But either way, I was obsessed with Back to the Future.
This is the year Punky Brewster was on in first run syndication, by the way. There's a really bad episode. Punky steals a pig to save it from becoming pork chops. Punky goes hog wild.
I don't remember that one. I feel like my Punky Brewster knowledge is fairly extensive.
The final season, a lot of people don't remember because it was almost off the air for a whole year and then came back in first run syndication, and she was much older,
right?
And it's a much more children aimed show. Like, it's way sillier and there's no more special episodes.
So they're older, but it's more
sillier. Dumbed down.
That's weird.
It's very strange.
Huh.
It's very strange. There was four shows that came back in first run syndication that way. Charles in Charge, Punky Brewster, Different Strokes. We got it made and it's a living.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah, because Punky Brewster was on NBC, right? And then it
and
moved to syndication?
What happened was it got canceled, but it did so well in reruns and syndication that the syndicate commissioned a new season for first run syndication.
Wow.
Because it was so popular.
So huge. It was
huge. Like 6 o'clock and, you know, after school, and kids would watch it.
Mm-hmm.
Desperately Seeking Susan premieres on television that night.
Yes, I saw that.
A movie I loved. So did you go Back to the Future or?
I went Back to the Future. I also, you know, probably at the time I would have been flipping between that and Perfect Strangers.
Yes.
Which was apparently on Wednesdays, which I don't. It was on Fridays eventually, right?
It was part of, like, Wednesdays the TGIF. Was the first season, and then they moved it to Fridays and built TGIF in 88.
Okay, so this is the first season.
Yep.
Okay.
TGIF hadn't started yet,
okay.
And Just the 10 of Us was on, and they had that on Friday nights as well as Mr. Belvedere.
Okay, and I saw the Full House was on.
Full House
on
just moved to Fridays, and Miller Boyette, Casey Warner? No, it was Miller Boyette. They produced all the shows in TGIF. That was their idea.
Mm-hmm.
Belvedere was canceled, so they inserted a new show. And they didn't produce Just the 10 of Us. So the show was really popular, but they got it canceled because they wanted to have only shows they produced in the Friday night 2-hour block, and they didn't have any place to move Just the 10 of Us to, so they just canceled it.
Wow.
Even though it was a big rating show.
Mm-hmm.
But the Miller Boyette production company is so powerful that they were like, we want it moved, and they're like, done.
We got this Urkel kid we want to show off to the American public.
So it was crazy. But Perfect Strangers was on. Hooper Man was also on, which was John Ritter.
I saw that listed, and I don't remember.
Love what that show. Is. John Ritter's like a police negotiator.
Oh, that does sound vaguely familiar.
In San Francisco.
John Ritter is amazing.
It was great. And then Dabney Coleman was in a show after that called The Slap Maxwell Story, where Dabney Coleman's like an angry private detective.
Of course he was.
<That's> Which I really liked, and people didn't enjoy that.
Huh.
This is the first season of Perfect Strangers. Highway to Heaven is on, also a show that I just bums me out so much and I hated, but because there's always a Jesus show on.
Right.
And this was the Jesus show.
That's true, isn't it?
Yeah, it was replaced by Touched by an Angel was kind of like the one after that, and then Early Edition, and, you know, but the plots of these shows are always insane. That being said, I do want to mention Highway to Heaven has two of my all-time favorite Halloween episodes ever. Legitimately, non-ironically, just really good.
I don't remember them.
They're great. One's called I Was a Middle-Aged Werewolf.
Oh, that's great. From Michael Landon.
Landon wrote and directed it. And that's great. It's really great.
Mm-hmm.
But this one is a blind actor played, who's Tom Sullivan, who's really a blind actor, plays an athlete who expects to gain his sight, but must counsel a bitter surfer who's sure to lose his. What? I don't understand.
There's no noun there.
This I bothers don't understand. Me.
His so what?
He's getting his sight back.
Oh.
Through surgery or something, but he's also counseling a guy who's losing in the process of going blind.
This sounds convoluted.
It does really sound convoluted, but I'm actually kind of curious now.
Me too.
Perfect Strangers that night, Balky gets conned by a man selling phony watches and jewelry, prompting the guys to concoct a scheme to put him out of business.
Thinking back on it, I'm sure I saw all these shows with grown-ups and thought, this is what adults do.
Yeah.
Every day. Like, yeah, there's
constantly.
They have to have some kind of scheme to get themselves out of something.
Yeah.
There is a cousin from a fictional, you know,
Greek island. Greek of island.
Like, oh, this is what adults do.
Yeah.
This is what my parents do all day
yeah.
at school when they teach and are guidance counselors. Yeah.
Sometimes the world looks perfect. Nothing to rearrange. Mm-hmm. I think I might record a cover of that and release it and just have a huge hit.
The theme songs then just
yeah,
were gorgeous.
Same sort of gravelly voiced guy singing it.
Mm-hmm. And it always builds to this emotional climax that has nothing to do with yep. the show.
Yeah, the best part of Perfect Strangers is, it's my life, it's my dream, nothing's gonna stop me now. And then that little harmonica.
Yeah.
Perfect. Head of the Class is also on, which I loved.
I saw that once in a while and liked it, but I wasn't obsessed with it.
I feel like you need to watch that as a high school teacher.
You know, I should. I wonder how many shows like that sort of inform how I thought teachers acted. Like, not consciously, yeah. but I'm sure it's in there somewhere.
There was a lot of teacher shows. There was pretty much, thinking about it, a teacher show every decade until the 2000s.
You had Welcome Back, Cotter.
Welcome Back, Cotter. You had Room 222 before that. In the 80s, you know, you had Head of the Class. You had Saved by the Bell.
Of course.
Which started as a teacher show, Good Morning, Miss Bliss.
Right, with Haley Mills.
Yep. In the 90s, you had Hanging with Mr. Cooper.
Oh, right.
You had Mr. Rhodes, Tom Rhodes' show.
Mm-hmm.
You had, there was Drexel's Class with Dabney Coleman.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there was a lot of those teacher shows.
Mm-hmm.
And, I don't think there's any in the 2000s. There may be some that I don't know of. But you always had that, which is kind of a weird workplace to have a show, like to have a standard That's sitcom true. Show about a teacher.
Right. And it's funny, I teach at the high school I went to.
Oh, weird.
Which I'm still like so thankful for.
Are there teachers there still who taught you?
Yes. Weird. And there are teachers I loved having, and the fact that I can't call them by their first names no matter how
yeah,
I try.
I'm sure they don't care.
No, I hope they like it. We'll see if any are like, no, you should call me Bill now. You're 37.
But, even though my name's Dave.
Right. It's been great, but I really wonder, is like, what is this going to be like?
Yeah. Yeah. And I wonder if there's any teachers who are like, the most accurate portrayal of teachers in a television show is.
Right.
And I can't even think of what it would be.
I don't know either. I think, you know, Mr. Cotter is sort of, I think, what we all aspire to. It's like they trust him,
but also they're like hanging out with him.
That's true.
That's weird. They like show up at his house.
True. You
know? Like that's
that is not okay.
Yeah.
One time, so the radio station at our school, in every morning, kids do announcements about like upcoming events and stuff, and they play a song. And I think it was coming back from April break. They played the theme song to Welcome Back, Cotter as sort of like, you know, welcome back to school.
Right.
And I just had this moment. I was like, oh, I'm Mr. Cotter. That's so strange.
I mean, you do have an enormous perm and a huge mustache.
Yeah. And they do tell me to, is it the kids who say up your nose with a rubber hose?
Yes. Yeah.
Horseback.
Yeah. And when you pulled up, there's a bunch of dudes in your car, high school dudes, that insisted I call them the Sweathawks.
Yeah, yeah.
They're just so, you know, they're, in the car. Yeah,
I never put that together, that parallel.
Yeah, it is pretty obvious. anything else you had on Wednesday?
No, that's it.
Thursday night, what'd you get?
Oh, well, Cheers.
Yeah, you got to do Cheers.
And I think I mentioned I read the main article on that issue. It's so interesting. Like, just as knowing how great Kirstie Alley was, and I think I prefer her to Shelley Long and Diane. Like,
I mean, I really know. Like Shelley Long, but Shelley Long's intentionally an annoying character,
right? And she did a great job at being that annoying character. But just Kirstie Alley's comedic chops are just astounding.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's a quote in there. One of the producers, I think, says, like, we made a conscious choice not to go with a comedian.
Yeah,
and so they didn't think of her. Apparently, as a comedian going into that new...
She's a dramatic actress.
Yeah.
Yeah. Shelley Long was a Second City person.
That's right.
She was a sketch comedy person. And it really made her name in nightlife. Mm-hmm. Not nightlife. Night Shift.
Okay.
Ron Howard's first big hit.
Mm-hmm.
But Cheers that night as Sam and Woody are up for grabs at a charity auction at Cheers, but are less than thrilled with the women who grab them. Again, the charity auction thing, where you buy
that
a person.
That was an angle of the sitcom.
I've never seen that happen.
No.
It seems a little weird.
That does seem weird. And like just Sam's whole persona that we all laughed with.
Yeah.
As like this misogynistic and like mocked him too a little bit for it. But like it's just funny how like our sympathy was entirely with him and he was
Ted Danson's so likable.
Oh, he's so likable.
And when I had him on the show, he
You had him on the show.
I did have him on the show.
Oh.
And he pointed out something that I got more emails about from Cheers fans who never put this together, and it like blew their minds about the way he played Sam. And he's like, Sam's a sad character. Mm-hmm. He's an alcoholic and he's never going to have someone. Mm-hmm. Even if he's not drinking, he's an alcoholic. He's always going to be alone. And he goes, and that's his name, Sam Malone.
Oh, wow.
He's like, that's what I used to play him. That's his name, Sam Malone.
Do you know if that was intentional?
I don't know. I mean, he thinks it was. He played it like it was.
Yeah.
But there were literally everyone I know was like, I never thought of that.
That's fantastic.
And that's how he played it. And I instantly was like, I gotta go rewatch this.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, all right. So even though like your sympathy, like you like him, it's still, he's pathetic.
Right.
It's everyone on the show is a sad character that, you know, you feel bad for.
It's true. Yeah. And even just like, you know, as an English teacher now, this sounds crazy, but like there's like some symbolism in that like coffee cup he had. Everyone else was like downing the beers and everything, and he had just had this coffee cup he would refill sometimes and like sip from. There was a little sadness to that
but he also is feeling superior to them.
That's true.
I mean,
he's sober. Yeah,
he's sober, and also he holds the keys to their vice. You know, which he, you know, sometimes they're more overt about him, you know, holding that over them. But that's why I don't like Frasier. The show Frasier, and I liked Frasier on Cheers because he's that sort of vice and that weakness. Sorry, everybody, to call alcoholism a weakness, is a great equalizer in that you have a psychiatrist in there, with a mailman and whatever the hell Norm was,
accountant/painter,
and then just like, you know, blue collar people, and you know, and Norm hates his wife,
right?
Like he doesn't want to be at home,
right.
Which they play for laughs, but is really sad. Accurate and sad for a lot of those guys.
And they're there all the time.
Yeah, that's their home, and that's really sad.
That's true. And Frasier, like, I love the show Frasier, but it's so different.
It's
and,
not
like,
the same character.
No, it's really not. And it's very strange how much he changes.
He's a flawed, fallen academic on Cheers.
Yeah.
And
he's much more human.
Yeah. And he started as Diane's boyfriend.
Right.
And much older boyfriend and her professor taking advantage of her. Which and they played it like that's a sleazy movie.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. I never thought of that.
Yeah. So it's a really interesting and it really points to how great the people who ran that show was, that they were able to make characters who on paper and by deed should be unlikable, really likable, sympathetic characters, which is great.
Yeah.
This is the episode where they're up for auction. I do want to mention that this is the year of some very high concept sitcoms. Like, not since the 70s did we see so many high concept sitcoms, as we sort of detailed earlier on the Fox night. And ABC had a show on called The Charmings. Do you remember the show?
No.
The premise of the show is Prince Charming and Snow White are enchanted into a slumber for hundreds of years and wake up in modern day Burbank, where they live together with her mother, her stepmother, and a dwarf.
No.
in a suburban house in a neighborhood and have to deal like a very Munster style show. No. Oh yes. Oh. It lasted 2 seasons. This one is
2 seasons.
2 seasons. The flu bug arrives in the Charming's household, and when Lillian, who is the evil stepmother, catches it, she sneezes her powers out the window.
What?
Yep. Paul Winfield played the magic mirror. Huh. Bernie Coppell is in this episode. It's very interesting show.
It's so like I sort of wish now that I, even though I did desperately want to talk about Cheers because my wife is probably tired of hearing me talk about it. So yeah. I get to talk to someone else. But I do wish I had gone with sort of a later issue because so much of this is off my radar.
Yeah.
But it's also fascinating to hear about.
You have a huge list of things to go back and rewatch now. Yeah. The Charmings.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. And Night Court is on, which I love. This is a really good episode. It's a seductress beckons Dan into her trap while Harry embarks on an 11th hour crusade to prevent a masked TV hero of bygone days from riding off into his last sunset. Terry Hatcher plays the seductress.
Oh, of course.
In this episode. There was a lot of suicide on Night Court.
Hmm.
Like, at least once a season, they had to talk someone out of killing themselves.
Was it treated seriously?
Yeah, well, my wife always calls it the Night Court moment, but it would be a sort of a comedy setup, but then when Harry's being, like, very sincere and, like, the moment when he ends up convincing them to give him the gun or get off the ledge or defuse the bomb or whatever it was, is always very, very serious.
It's so funny how so many sitcoms at that time had that abrupt tonal shift from...
Yeah.
Like dumb silliness to like, oh, special episode
time. Oh yeah. And Night Court did it well. I mean, they the people, Reinhold Wiese who created Night Court came out of Barney Miller and that show was perfect with that tone.
Mm-hmm.
And he, I think, learned some really good lessons on that. Night Court was definitely sillier than Barney Miller.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes they played it well. Sometimes it didn't mix at all, but sometimes it played really well. Like one of my favorite episodes is when all these people escape an insane asylum and they don't want to go back because they're saying they're abused there.
This is Night Court or
Night Court? Night Court. And there's one woman who hasn't spoken in 30 years and that's why she's in there. Like she saw her husband get killed or something like that. And they're playing up that like maybe she's gonna speak at the end, and she hands Harry a note, and then leaves. And they play it like, oh my god, like what is this? What did she say? What is it? And he opens it up and he looks at it. And he goes, I have no idea. And then he goes, apparently she hasn't written in 30 years either. And like, that's it. That's the ending.
Oh, that's great.
And you're like thinking it's going to be this. Yeah. Like, but it's really funny because it plays
great.
With the sort of.
That's you know, like on the first, I think it's the very first episode of the Cosby Show. There's that heart to heart between Theo and I know the Cosby Show. I was also in love with. And
again, aside from him being a monster, it's a really good show.
It is. And it's, I'm so sad. I mean, he is definitively a monster. And I will in no way defend him. But it's just so sad that that is the outcome that I can't. I mean, I could watch it again, and you know, you could argue like the artist versus the art, all that.
But there's so many people that made that show, like especially the TV show, more than anything else. Less so now because we have more auteur shows.
Right.
Is a group effort, and
everyone on that show is so funny.
Everyone's great. The writers are great. The showrunners are great. You know, the scenes with him and kids is really funny.
Yeah,
and
it really does hold up.
Yeah.
And that moment where. Theo says this heartfelt thing about how he deserves better, or like I don't even remember the angle.
He's like, Dad, you know, he basically tries to play him and say like I'm trying, and he looks at him and goes, that is the dumbest thing.
It's amazing.
Yeah, it's and totally unexpected because it plays with our
you
know conceptions of television,
right?
At the time, the sort of Leave It to Beaver show,
mm-hmm.
and again, I think that was we had. The sort of tail end of the first generation of people that grew up watching television, making television.
Hmm.
So they were able to play on that stuff.
Yeah, right.
And even us as kids, because we would still see Leave It to Beaver and stuff and Lassie when we were kids because they played stuff from the beginning of television.
Right.
It was easy for us to tap into that because we had almost the same sort of, we did the prerequisite work.
Right, right.
Inadvertently.
Mm-hmm.
So we got that sort of rich, we understood what they were doing.
Right.
Whether we, you know, not intentionally.
Mm-hmm.
But, and that was really rewarding.
Absolutely.
To do that. Oh. Friday night, is that the last night you picked?
Friday, I have Friday and Saturday.
Okay.
What did I do for Friday? You know, I think I probably went with, oh, you know what I noticed? Okay, this was fascinating to me. I asked you earlier what CBN stood for.
Yes, I was curious why you had asked me that.
Because that night, and I vaguely remember the Family Channel sort of starting around that time, which is what CBN turned into. Is that right?
I believe so, yeah.
And yeah, they have like the 700 Club and like some like overtly Christian thing. But that night they have all this old time comedy.
Yeah.
That I think probably back then I actually would have been intrigued by, like Burns and Allen and Jack Benny. I had this like set of like cassettes from of old radio shows that I loved, and like how I ever found them or got into them, I don't remember. But there was like an episode of like Suspense with an exclamation point, and
The Witching Hour.
I think they were all dramatic ones. I don't remember if I had any comedy ones, but Jack Benny remains like one of my comedic heroes. Just so funny.
And Burns and Allen too, and I mean they were doing fourth wall breaking stuff when they moved on to TV, because they'd been doing this sitcom stuff for 10 years on radio, and they directly moved it to TV, and they were doing a talk to the audience, you know, which again was a real vaudeville thing,
right? Like
Hell's a Poppin' thing, but bringing that to TV was really strange. It now seems innovative, but that again was like kind of around since the beginnings of television, depending on who you were, you know, looking at.
Right.
And 87 was also the year its Gary Shandling show started, which was also very fourth wall breaking. Yeah, there's a lot of interesting stuff that started in 87.
Yeah, and that was one of the theme song. It's like,
this is the theme of Gary show. Yeah, yeah. Rags to Riches is on this night. It's the Thanksgiving episode of Full House. I Married Dora is on, which was a show that I loved and blew my mind.
You know, I avoided putting Full House down there just because I think... I don't know if the world needs another 37-year-old white man talking about Full House.
Yeah.
But maybe, I don't know, maybe they do.
This is the first season.
And I definitely loved it.
Yeah, I watched it. I don't know if I would say I loved it, but I watched it.
Yeah, that's a good point. It was there.
Yeah.
It's sort of like Mount Everest.
This episode of Mr. Belvedere that night is Belvedere is getting too big for his britches and goes on a diet while Marsha's boss seems interested in more than her court case briefs.
Ooh. That sounds interesting.
Sexual harassment was big in 87. It's big now. But it was it did get a lot of... it was the topic of a lot of stuff.
Was Anita Hill the...
Anita Hill was 92,
Later, yeah.
But you had, like, Fatal Attraction in 87.
Yeah, right.
But they started to do a lot of the stuff. Night Court had a sexual harassment episode.
Okay.
Facts of Life had one. But it was more like bosses, like skirt chasing their, you know, the woman. And it was interesting, though, to be like, that's not okay, you know?
Right.
We never really heard that in things before.
Right.
And the 70s shows, it was kind of like, the boss is a horny guy. Right. And he loves his suit. It's fine, you know? But it's not fine.
Right.
And this was the first year that I remember a lot of television showing that. Anything else you have that night?
No, I just found that so fascinating that that was there at all. And I really want to go back and watch it.
Yeah, you should. It's great.
I mean, I would have been watching probably Full House and Mr. Belvedere.
Yeah.
But that's what I went with.
As you should have. And then what'd you have on Saturday? Is the final night that you picked?
Yeah.
This is a great issue, by the way. Like, I'm just flipping through this, and there's so many great ads and articles. Like, I think the rest of my day is set now. I'm just going to reread this from cover to cover.
Good. No, I'm glad. that's my job, is to inspire literacy in
I don't know if you saw this, actually. It's on, this is an LA edition of TV Guide on Channel 5 in LA. It's Muppet Weekend.
What? I didn't see that.
Yeah, it's Muppet Weekend.
Oh, that's, so that's on Saturday, and then The Great Muppet Caper is on Sunday, which is my Sunday choice.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. So what'd you go with on Saturday?
Well, Golden Girls is there, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Golden Girls is on.
That was one of the things. Where, and looking back now, it's pretty filthy.
It's completely filthy.
So it's weird that my parents let me watch it.
I think they got away with it because it was old people.
Right.
Even though they were like 50. It was also, for a lot of parents, the actresses on that show were actresses they grew up with in sitcoms.
Sure. Like B. Arthur
was on Maude.
Yeah.
Betty White was on Game Shows Forever,
Mary Tyler Moore.
Like, they knew her. Rue McClanahan was on Mama's Family and a bunch of other stuff. So they were like, I think, weirdly comfortable with those actresses. And I think that helped with kind of overlooking the sexual stuff in that show.
Yeah, I bet you're right. Especially with my parents, like, they would tell me, and when I interviewed Bob Newhart, it was like my mom to her as if I interviewed Michael Jackson Kanye West. Like, yeah. Because when they would tell me stories, like Saturday night, we'd sit down and watch Mary Tyler Moore Show, Bob Newhart Show. That was our Saturday night. So that makes sense. That Betty White was like... especially, I think.
Yeah, beloved. Like, they trust that person, you know, so it doesn't seem as sleazy. But, I mean, it was one of the first shows to talk about condoms. Not the first show. That was Valerie.
Interesting.
Justine Bateman, I believe, was the first actor to utter the word condom on television.
This is Valerie, not Valerie's family.
Valerie Harper. Yes, before she was killed off on the show, which is a very touchy subject.
Right. But with you or just in general?
With me.
Oh, okay.
It was... Oof. But Golden Girls that night, it takes nerves, but Blanche makes a move on Ted, the brother of Dorothy's ex, the minute she learns he's a neurosurgeon. McLean Stevenson plays Ted of the Mary Tyler Moore Show. Was McLean Stevenson on Mary Tyler Moore?
I don't. It doesn't sound right.
Guy McLeod was on there. What was McLean Stevenson from? I feel like he was on.
I know the
MTM
name,
show.
But I don't know. You might
read in. It's early on a Sunday, but it was a very good episode. Anything else you picked that night?
I went with just Golden Girls. You know, as time went on, it was Golden Girls and Empty Nest and Sisters.
Nurses.
I forgot about Nurses. That was a spinoff of Empty Nest.
Spinoff of a spinoff.
Wow.
Yep. Yeah.
And it actually stuck around, didn't it?
It lasted longer than Empty Nest.
Oh, wow.
It went into the 90s, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's, again, like, probably an instance where it's like, oh, this is how adults adult.
Yeah, this is a hospital show. There's always a hospital show on, too. Always.
That's interesting.
We've had hospital shows since the beginning of television.
Wow.
I'd be hard-pressed to find, definitely not a decade, but I think maybe even a year where a hospital show didn't air.
Because you had, like, emergency... Back in the day.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, General Hospital and stuff too, but not counting those. Yeah, I mean, you had
St. Elsewhere.
Huh. You had Empty Nest, ER, both versions of ER, Chicago Hope, Nurses. There's just been so many doctor, nurse, hospital set shows for whatever reason. And then Sunday, you went with the Muppets. That was all you had?
I think just because I've seen it recently, that's probably the one I've seen the fewest times out of the classic three Muppet movies.
Yeah.
And it's very funny.
It's great. Yeah.
They're all so funny.
I think Muppets Take Manhattan is the best one.
I like that one a lot. I think the first one is still going to be my favorite no matter what. If only for Rainbow Connection, which we still sing with our daughters.
Paul Williams' finest
very
song.
very often at night. Yeah. Oh, it's so good.
I mean, I will make a controversial statement.
Okay.
I actually think Follow That Bird, not counting Labyrinth and Dark Crystal, I think Follow That Bird is my favorite Muppet movie.
You know, I don't remember it well enough, but
love it.
I'll allow it.
Yeah. I recommend maybe previewing it with your kids. I mean, I think they can handle it. But it's very, very, very good. And funny, the whole cast of SCTV is in it, by the way. Joe Flaherty, Dave
strange.
Thomas. It's really strange.
Catherine O'Hara.
It's funny and weird and sad and interesting and just really good.
I will check it out.
And I saw that in the theater. I was so excited. I was a big Sesame Street kid.
Mm-hmm.
That was the first Muppet movie... I think I might have seen Great Muppet Caper in the theater. Was that 83, 82?
Yeah.
Something like that?
It's the second one.
Right. Or what's the third one?
Third one is Muppets Take Manhattan.
Is it? I thought that was the second one. I think Muppet Caper is the third one.
You might be right.
That's the only one I saw in the theater.
Okay.
Because the other two were before I was born.
Okay.
But I was young. I didn't really remember it. But Follow That Bird... was like, I remembered like anticipating it coming out, getting really excited to see it. And like,
I don't know it doesn't make sense that I wasn't immediately into it.
When you were five.
Yeah.
I was five, but I was much more fixated on that stuff, I'm sure. It's just really funny.
I'll check it out.
Yeah.
I do like the moment when Big Bird shows up in the Muppet movie.
It's great.
My kids, like, I don't even remember if they've seen the whole thing yet, but they just freak out.
It blows their mind, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you been to the Museum of the Moving Image in Queens?
No.
They have a Henson exhibit, and it's a permanent exhibit. And I went a couple weeks ago, and I just cried the whole time. But it was, thankfully, it was kind of no one there. But it's all his handwritten notes and all the original puppets, original Big Bird, original Rolf.
Wow.
Just there. And it blew me away. Like, I couldn't believe it. But one of the coolest things, especially as someone of the Muppet movies, a fan of the Muppet movies, is all the sets they had to make in miniature and cardboard before to, like, figure out how to work, because they all had to be built raised up so the puppeteers can be underneath.
Of course. That makes
sense.
So
they have his original mock-up of the church from the wedding.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, cardboard, and it has the underneath all designed, so where the puppeteers will go and where all the characters are, and the lockers where they all live in, I think, Muppets Take Manhattan. They're all living in the lockers.
Yes.
The bus station.
Right.
Same thing, cardboard underneath, and he has the wedding Miss Piggy is there. the full wedding, Miss Piggy.
When you think about the astounding amount of work that it went, not only that, but like Sesame Street on a regular basis, like I it boggles my mind.
He changed a generation. I mean, like in his aesthetic, he was a really subversive humanist. The good aspect that I like of hippies, which was that kind of angry, like you're screwing us all over. You're ruining it for us. Mm-hmm. You know, humans are ruining it for themselves. That was his view. Mm-hmm. And you know, it could show like dinosaurs, which was maybe the most subversive show ever on television.
It's so strange.
And they killed them all at the end. You know, and environmentalism and just being like not being a jerk and being a human being, it's amazing. What he did was just amazing.
And I remember the day he died very clearly.
It was very traumatic.
I think that was the first celebrity death that I was like, oh no.
We were 10. It was 90.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And he had so much. Oh, that's one of the heartbreaking things in that exhibit is they have his notes of plans.
Oh.
And because he was doing the Muppet Hour. The Jim Henson Hour at that time.
Yeah, I remember
which
that.
Was a half hour of the new Muppet Show, which was great. And the storyteller. And he had plans for that. And it didn't get canceled. It ended because he died.
Was he planning the Muppet Christmas Carol as well?
Or he had that, done I know that was after some him, but... of that, but that's the last thing I think that had his touch on it. I don't like it. I don't like it. You know, I don't like post Henson Muppets. It's just not the same.
It's just, yeah, it feels strange.
Yeah.
I get to interview people I admire on a fairly regular basis. I'm very lucky, and I got to interview because he's from Acton. I got to interview Carol Spinney.
Yeah, people don't know he's Oscar the Grouch and he's Big Bird.
And he too, like Bob Newhart, was just like the nicest, exactly as you would hope Big Bird would be.
Yeah,
it was just.
I mean, I think one of the things that, you know, Newhart's like this too, but not having talked to him, I only assume. But Carol Spinney's also one of those guys that they understand what their work means to people. Mm-hmm. And also that they were lucky to have worked with someone like Henson and that they are a better person having worked with him, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's amazing that they're still around and we get to, you know, interact with them when we do.
Right. Oh yeah.
Anything else you had in there, or is that everything?
That was everything, I think.
Cool. Well, thank you so much for a great
talk. Thank you. I obviously have no name recognition, and I can't imagine when subscribers see the name, they'll be
Bruiser Bruise, the wrestler.
That's true. Actually. They'll be like, that guy is trouble.
Yeah.
But I really appreciate this is so much fun to be able to do.
So oh yeah, absolutely. So I'm always happy to talk to fellow TV generation kids. Thank you. There you go, Bruiser Bruise. Great guy. I really like talking to him. And I really liked having you guys hear me talk to people all year. I thank you again. We have more coming up in 2018. I'm not stopping yet. And if half the things I have planned for the next year come to pass, it will be an excellent, excellent year. So thank you again for being around and listening. If you'd like to email me, you can do so at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at ken@icanread.com. Icanread.com, of course, being my stand-up comedy page. I am still a stand-up comedian for the moment. So if you want to see where I'm performing, you can go on that page and see. You can buy my albums. You can buy TV Guidance Counselor merchandise. You can go to our Patreon, patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. Every dollar helps. I cannot thank everybody enough who has contributed to that. That does help directly to the show. Helps me pay for web hosting, for travel. It'll help pay for my next trip out to LA to gather some great episodes for you guys. So I thank you again for that. You can tweet to us at TV Guidance or at Kenneth W. Reed. I have an Instagram now for the show. I have a personal one at Kenneth W. Reed as well, but at TV Guidance for Instagram. Post different stuff on there if you want to follow along. And we'll see you again next Wednesday for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Right, I suppose I should be flattered. And I do have a bruiser tattooed on me, but yes, still.
Right across the chest.